Church, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your sovereign control over every situation. In a world that seems chaotic, you are in control. You're unsurprised at anything that happens. And Father, these students are going out into a world that is different than we've seen in a long, long time. And Father, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll put a shield around them. I pray in Jesus' name that they could be a light for the world. They could be the salt that goes out and changes the world, changes culture. Father, I pray of all the plans that they have, of all the different individual wills that they are going to apply to their next steps, Father, I pray that your will be done in their lives, that you will bless their future spouses, their future families. Father, let us trace back to even this moment and even this prayer, a time where you were moving. Maybe some students are on the edge, whether or not they're going to go their own way or follow you. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that they pick you. And Father, I pray that as we send these students out, I pray you'll remind us to pray for them and all other seniors that are graduating, that are facing a different world than we have ever seen before, probably in the United States. And so Father, I pray you'll use these students, these men and women, for your glory. And I pray, Father, that they will be appreciative to a family, parents, a church that loves them and pour deeply into them so that they may know you, Jesus, and make you known. We praise you. Also, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Celebration, this is your 2021 graduate class.
Breathe. Isn't it a magnificent sight to see the students up on the platform? Welcome, students. Can we welcome them one more time? I mean, it's not just because one of them is mine that I feel like it's a special day. But it's a very special day. And you may remember a couple of weeks ago when we had kids and babies being dedicated, we sang a song over them. And I just think that it would be neat. I'm not going to get them to move. There's just too many of them. So can we just sing the second part of this song as if we're singing over them, that they would experience the presence of the Lord and the outpouring of Him? Because that's what you need. That's what we all need. So let's lead us.
I mentioned there just a moment ago that I've been out a good bit over the last couple of weeks. In fact, I've missed three Sundays in a row. That never happens. I'm too big of a church junkie for that. But my son has been adulting big time over the last few weeks. In fact, in the month of May, he graduated from college, got married, and moved to Tennessee to start his new job. And so I took a couple of weeks off to help him adult, and we did exciting things like get his phone moved off of my account onto his own account. Blessings from God. Just wonderful things have occurred, and I'm very proud of him. He's all set up, be starting a new job as a nurse on the cardio floor of a hospital there in Chattanooga in the next few days. So just very happy for him. Now, as I thought about my son adulting and just sort of watched all that occur, I thought back to my own experience when I wrapped up college and kind of went on from that moment. Do y'all remember? Many of y'all have experienced that. You remember that moment in your own life. And for me, my wife and I, we were married as college kids, and my wife and I moved to Lusaka, Zambia to be journeyman missionaries with the International Mission Board. So I graduated or wrapped up college in December, and we were on the field in Zambia in early February. Okay, so just literally just a couple of weeks between being in college and being in a whole other country. And so we're in Lusaka, Zambia, the capital city of that country in southern Africa. And I am a basketball coach at a local high school. Y'all did not laugh at me nearly as much as the first service did. In the first service, they just laughed out loud. They didn't even slow down. And I know I don't look like much of a basketball coach. I get that. But coaching basketball, coaching sports was a great way to get onto school campuses. And so I coached basketball. I taught religious education in a local public high school. And the team that I coached, we had some real athletes. Y'all, we were good. We were competitive. And through that process, one of the other missionaries on the field also, a colleague of mine, was the basketball coach at the University of Zambia. So again, just a great way to get on campuses there was coaching. And because I coached and he coached, we became buddies. We kind of connected. His name was Lonnie. And Lonnie was, let me see how I put this. He was from the rough and tumbled branch of the Christian family tree. Well, what do I mean by that? Well, Lonnie was from Kentucky. More specifically, he was from Greasy Creek, Kentucky, okay, which was way up in cold country, and it was where you go and you hear banjos, right, as you're walking down the street kind of place. And he grew up hard. He married when he was only 16 years of age. He and Fran married quite young. And Lonnie was very much, he loved the Lord. He was a wonderful Christ follower. But you could just tell when you were around Lonnie that the mean streak wasn't buried too deep. You know what I'm saying? And I think some of the other missionaries there on the field were a little afraid of him. I mean, I'm not saying he wasn't walking the Lord. He absolutely was. But you did not want to poke this bear. Okay, are you with me? So Lonnie says to me one day, he says, David, I've got, you know, an opportunity to launch a new Bible study with all these students from the University of Zambia, and it would just mean the world to me if you would come and you would teach that Bible study. You know, it's a big kickoff. It's a big deal. Would you come and would you lead in that opportunity? And I said, man, I would be honored. Yeah, sure, no problem. And, you know, remember, I'm really young. Okay, I'm going to make an excuse for myself right there. And I said, sure, I'll be happy to do that for you. You all, I never thought of that commitment again. Not ever. It just went sailing from one ear to the other. Never thought of that commitment again. Day of the Bible study comes, I'm not there. And I never thought about it. It never occurred to me. I see Lonnie a couple of days later. This is before cell phones when you could just call somebody up and chew them out, you know. This required a good face-to-face chewing out. I see Lonnie a couple of days after the Bible study. And as soon as he lays his eyes on me, his countenance fell, to use the biblical term. He looked at me and Greasy Creek came through. And he didn't say hello, he didn't say anything. He walked up to me, and I mean, he lit me up. Now, I'm young, okay? I thought of myself as somewhat charming. And in my lifetime as a young guy, I'd always kind of been able to kind of weasel my way out of being forgetful, right? Lonnie would have none of it. He would not let me off the hook. He kept coming and coming and coming. I mean, he was in my face, you all. And he told me this. He said, David, if I let you get away with this, if I let you get away with this, you're never going to be able to be an effective minister because no one is going to buy you because you won't have any integrity at all. Now, let me tell you, getting lit up by Lonnie like that was no fun. It was no fun. I remember that. And I bear those scars to this day. Let me ask you a question. Was Lonnie right? Oh, yeah. Lonnie was right. And that moment for me with Lonnie was absolutely pivotal in helping me kind of get onto a much better path toward integrity. Mark Richt is an analyst with ESPN. You all may have heard of him. He was the football coach at the University of Miami. Prior to that, football coach at the University of Georgia. And if you know, if you've been around Tallahassee a while, you know he was also the offensive coordinator for Bobby Bowden during the great championship runs back in the 90s and so here at Florida State. I had the opportunity to sit down with Coach Richt. He's got a huge reputation of being a man of integrity. I had the chance to catch up with him and talk to him about how that was kind of fomented in his life. Take a look at part of that conversation right now. And Mark, as I mentioned, we're talking about integrity today. I'm sure that you've encountered men and women of great integrity who've leveraged their integrity for the influence of others. And so who are some of those people that come to mind for you?
So I would start with my dad. He was a very quiet man, a pretty unassuming guy, but his nickname actually at work at IBM was Honest Lou. But as far as integrity, I'd have to say Bobby Bowden next to my dad.
How did he influence you to become a person of integrity in your own right?
Well, I just watched him. You know, he modeled it. It was very simple to see the type of man he was working for. You know, you can't hide your warts for 15 years. You can't even do it for one season, for that matter.
What about your faith in Christ? How does your faith in Christ affect your drive to be a man of integrity?
Well, it affects everything. You know, if I were to say I had a life verse, it would be Colossians 3:23. You know, whatever you do, do you work heartily unto the Lord rather than men? I think people sometimes get too worked up about what's God want me to do? What's God want me to do? I don't know if he cares as much what we do, but how we do it. You know, when you are only accountable to man, to your boss, and he's watching you and you do things a certain way when he's watching you, what do you do when he's not watching you? Whereas if you do it unto the Lord, he sees everything and you know he sees everything. So that's the highest accountability a person can have. If we truly love God and we want to love him back, he wants us to obey.
So I think every leader who's interested in leading with a measure of integrity has got to deal with demonstrating that integrity when they're facing, you know, criticism for a decision they've made or for something that's happened. And as a coach, you dealing with the criticism was a part of your daily deal. I mean, you never got away from it.
Coach Bowden says, if you can't handle criticism, get out of coaching, because it's coming. And it's not just coaching, it's leadership, period, as you know. You could be a parent and you're a leader and you make a decision that your kids aren't really happy with. So, you know, there's going to be critics every time you make a decision. Someone's going to be happy and someone's going to be bent out of shape. And again, you have to decide who you're going to please. Once people understand, you know, who you are and what you're about, it's not going to shock them if you make certain decisions that would be in line with God's word.
Well, Mark, I'm so thankful that you've taken time to sit down with me today, and thanks for being a person of integrity and for all that you've modeled throughout your entire career.
I'm doing my best, and I'm getting there.
Yeah, give him a hand. By the way, if you want to hear the whole interview on our church app, we do a podcast. Listen to Mark Richt's interview there on the podcast. Would love for you to do that. Now, I hope that you, like Mark did, you had people in your life that have modeled integrity, pointed you toward integrity. Maybe it was somebody in your life like Lonnie was for me, and they really challenged you on the point of integrity. We talk about the commodity of integrity all the time. But let me just ask you, if you think about integrity, what is it made up of? What are the ingredients? What's the recipe for integrity? Most of us would very quickly say, well, integrity is all about honesty, right? But I think you would agree. We've all known people who were ruthlessly honest, but we didn't necessarily think of them as people of integrity. I would submit to you, there's more to integrity than just honesty, okay? And the very first item in the recipe is compassion. You might not go there right off the bat as you think about integrity, but walk with me down this road for a little bit. I think you'll understand. The word compassion literally means to stoop down to someone's level, to get down where they are and see things eye to eye, to understand their problems, understanding what they're going through, and then being moved to act. Jesus himself demonstrates great compassion, and he does so right off the bat. From his coming to earth, he demonstrates this kind of compassion. One of my favorite pieces of scripture is Philippians chapter 2, verse 6. Listen to what it says. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. Of all the things that Jesus achieved on the cross, and those achievements were many, one of the things that happened when he came was he stooped down to our level and he understood who we are. He showed great compassion. Hebrews talks about this. Hebrews 4:15 says, "This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings we do, yet he did not sin." Jesus shows compassion to us. He stoops down. He understands us at our level, and that's essential to integrity. When I show someone compassion, I'm connecting with them in the most authentic way possible. And without that connection, I don't believe you can really demonstrate integrity clearly at all. Not long ago, I had someone contact me, and they told me that they had lost their mom after an extended illness. Many of you have faced a similar circumstance. Now, for me, my tragedy was all happened when I was really young. I did not deal with or have not dealt with aging parents. I've dealt with that instead through the experiences of my wife. And you all know that last year, my wife's mom died after a bout with cancer. So as I'm talking to this person on the phone about losing their mom, in my mind, I went back and just intentionally sought to remember what we went through when we lost Pam's mom. I wanted to remember what it felt like to have that absolute gut punch of grief. I wanted to remember what it was like to be with my wife as she walked through all of those stages of grief. I wanted to be able to show compassion to that person because I knew that without compassion, I couldn't serve them with any measure of integrity at all. Now, this is a biblical process as well. Romans 12:15 says, "Be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep." Understand where people are. Compassion is critical to integrity. And without compassion and the connection that kind of cultivates, it's really hard to show integrity. Now think about it. How many of y'all have known somebody who was brutally honest but had no compassion? Know that person? Does that person come to mind? Do you think of that person as someone who has great integrity? Probably not. Think about that person who was a great problem solver, but they had no compassion. When you were around them, you probably just felt like you were part of the machine, part of the system, right? You didn't think of them as a person of great integrity. Probably think about somebody who really was firm in who they were in Christ, very outspoken believer in Jesus Christ. But if they weren't a person of compassion, you might have thought of them as a religious flake or a religious zealot. You didn't really think of them as a person of integrity. If I don't show compassion, there's no way that I can communicate integrity properly, okay? So that's the first ingredient. Now, the second ingredient I'll give to you is truth. And this is where all of us would typically start. We think about someone who tells the truth and who lives the truth. That's where we go to when we think about integrity. And that's true. Truth is a critical ingredient of integrity, which is kind of ironic because if we're honest, we'd have to admit that all of us lie. At least some of the time, right? And we lie for different reasons. Maybe you lie to spare someone else's feelings. Men, you all know the classic example of this, right? Your wife comes and says, "Do I look fat in this dress?" Your answer to that question is always, "Oh, you've never looked better, right? You look fantastic. What are you kidding me? You make that dress look great." You may not feel that way, but you want to spare her feelings. You're not going to say, "Well, now that you mention it," you wouldn't do that, right? You want to spare her feelings. Part of you might be thinking, "I'm not really trying to spare her feelings. I'm trying to save myself from further consequences, so I'm not going there," right? And that's another reason that we lie. We lie to spare ourselves from unpleasant consequences, and we do this all the time. But there's a problem with lying and it goes right to the heart of integrity. First of all, when I lie, I violate one of the Ten Commandments. Don't bear false witness, right? I don't do that. And let me just tell you right now, if you break commandments, your integrity is going to take a beating, okay? It's just, it's always going to work that way. Second thing that happens is when I lie to reduce the consequences, inevitably what happens to the consequences? They blow up. They blow up. It is a pay me now or pay me later situation with this, isn't it? A lot of years ago, a lady came to see me, and she's, you know, you can tell something's really heavy on her mind. And I knew this lady, great couple, great lady. She says to me, I've been dishonest with my husband, and there's no escaping it any longer. Well, immediately I began to think, you know, I know where this is going. Didn't go where I was thinking it was going to go at all. She said to me, a couple of years ago, I go out to the mailbox, pick out the mail, and there's some junk mail in there. And it's an offer from a credit card company. Anybody ever gotten one of those before? And she said, money is tight for us. And there were some things that I would like to have had for our home. And I thought, you know what? What's the harm? But I'm not going to tell my husband because he's very, very strict about credit, just doesn't believe in it. So I took out a credit card without him knowing it. Had a $2,000 limit. I thought, no problem. I can easily pay that back. Bought some things from the home on the card. Got to the end of the, you know, filled that card up and was really struggling to make the payments on that card. So another offer came in the mail. I took out another credit card. Do y'all see where this is going? $60,000 in debt. And her husband doesn't know. And she said, I can't keep it going anymore. I'm out of options. I'm starting to get phone calls. I'm heading them all off. They're all coming to my cell phone. My husband still doesn't know. What do I do? Well, guess what you get to do now? Now you get to do what? Tell the truth, which is what you should have been doing from the first day, right? So she sits her husband down and she tells him the truth. And y'all, he's devastated. Why is he devastated? He's not devastated just because of the financial hit, right? Why is he devastated? Because he'd been lied to. And how did that make him feel? Did that make him feel more valuable, less valuable? Less valuable. Now look what the Bible says about this. Proverbs 26, 28. A lying tongue hates its victims. You think he felt the love when he'd been lied to that way? It was devastating for their relationship. Few things to value people like lying to them. It absolutely runs roughshod over them. In fact, conversely, few things add value to people like telling them the truth. Look at Ephesians 4, 25. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are all members of one another. When I tell people the truth, when I show integrity by being honest with people, what am I doing? I'm saying, you are part of my family, man. You are part of my community. I add value to people. Now, not only is integrity about being truthful, it's also about dealing rightly with the truth. And for example, think back to the lady in the story I just shared with you. When you know you don't have a lot of money, you have to deal rightly with that truth. Okay? You don't just take out a bunch of credit card debt. You guys know that. Okay, you deal rightly with that truth. You do fun things like clipping coupons, right? Doing with less, ouch, that's no fun. Or maybe you retrain, you learn a new skill, you get a different job so that you can increase your income, but you deal rightly with the truth about where your finances are. You deal with it with great integrity. As a person of integrity, I tell the truth, I handle the truth so that I can be counted on to honor my word. If I make a commitment to something, I follow through with it. Remember my story with me and Lonnie? That was a lesson that I got to learn that day. One of the things I love about my wife is if she tells you she will do something, you can take it to the bank. It's going to happen. You never need to think about it again. And that's exactly what Jesus calls us to. Matthew 5, 37, just a simple yes, I will, or no, I won't. Anything beyond this is from the evil one. People should be so confident that when you say you're going to do it, you're going to do it, that a simple, yep, I gotcha, that's all it takes. They don't need to worry about it ever again. When you make a commitment, you follow through. And everybody knows that they can count on you because you're a person of the truth, you're a person who handles the truth well, and you're a person who speaks the truth, okay? Next ingredient, that sets us up, by the way, for this one, because the next ingredient is solving problems. If we handle the truth well, this is going to make this a lot easier. But let me just tell you something, and this may be a bit of a newsflash for you, okay? Life is hard. Is anybody stunned by that statement? Life is hard. In fact, Jesus promises us that life is hard. In John 16:33, he says, in this world you will have what? Trouble. That's a biblical promise you just don't see on very many bumper stickers, right? Life is hard. And if you doubt me, just relive 2020 in your brain for just a moment, right? Life is hard. You're going to have trouble. You're going to have problems. It's a guarantee. And it shouldn't come to you then as a great surprise that a person who has great integrity is also someone who solves problems with great maturity. Y'all, when you get hit with a problem, when somebody causes a problem in your workplace, for example, and they come to you and they're bringing you all this, it is so easy to respond to that badly, isn't it? And to not deal with problems well. And we looked at Ephesians 4:25 just a moment ago. Here it is again. Look at it on the screen. Okay, you see that? Look at the very next verse. Look at what it says about solving and dealing with problems. Verse 26 says, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. There's a couple of great truths here that apply when something goes wrong and we've got a problem to solve. First, when you are faced with a problem, you don't lose it. You might get upset, you might need to react, but you don't need to go to a place where you're sinning in your response. And the second thing this verse teaches us about this is simply deal with your problems promptly. You all, this has been one of my great problems throughout my lifetime. I don't always do a good job of dealing with problems now. Something happens, a problem comes up, and I begin to think to myself, if I just put that off. There's an old saying that someone told me years ago, and I've learned they are absolutely right. Here's the old saying, bad news doesn't get better with age. That is absolutely the truth. When you get bad news, when you find out about a problem, don't put off dealing with it. Tackle it right now, okay? So deal with things well, right? Don't sin as you deal with that thing when it comes up. Don't let your anger take you to a place where you shouldn't go, but don't put it off. Don't assume that if you just kick this thing down the road, it'll go away on its own. A person of integrity instead deals with a problem promptly, and they deal with it well. Now, I want you to think about that for a moment. How would you deal with a problem really well? Well, some of the steps that I take when I'm faced with a problem, let's say that something happens in the office, and we've got to deal with a serious problem. First thing that we stop and do is, okay, what is the biblical response to this thing? What does the Bible say to me about this? Sometimes I'll reach out and I'll seek godly counsel about this. Now, this doesn't mean I engage in gossip. I do not. I don't want to be a part of that. But I reach out to somebody that I believe is a little bit further along than me, which isn't hard to find. And I'll reach out to them and I'll say, hey, here's what I'm facing. What do you think? I've got two or three pastor friends that live in other cities. They've never been to Tallahassee, man. They don't know anything about this town. They don't know these people that are here. And so sometimes I'll call one of them and say, listen, this is a situation I'm dealing with. What do you think? So I'll seek some wise counsel, not gossiping, just seeking some wise counsel. Obviously, I pray about that problem. I go before the Lord and say, Lord, what should I do here? And then I seek the word. What does the Bible say to me about how I should respond to this issue, this problem? An important passage of scripture for me here on this is found in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit. Many of y'all know this verse of scripture, right? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. You know, this piece of scripture is memorized. It's firmly in my brain. And if I'm walking into a difficult meeting, I've told you all this about this before. If I'm walking into a difficult meeting, I'll stop before I go through that door and I'll go, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Which one of these qualities do I need to be sure that I'm demonstrating in this meeting that I'm about to go into right now? And I'll think it through, and I'll pick one. I'll say, okay, whatever you do, don't leave this room without demonstrating that fruit of the Spirit very clearly. Sometimes I find myself walking out of a meeting, I'm going, okay, where did I go wrong there? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Oh, that's where I missed it, right? And I troubleshoot that way. A couple of years ago, I had mentioned this in the sermon, walked into one of our church members' office at their workplace, and I looked at their computer monitor, and stuck to the side of it was a little note, and on it was a list, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I said, hey man, I love your note. He said, I got this from you. I said, there you go, that's great, that's fantastic. He said, you know what, I find this so helpful because I do a lot of email in my work life, and I get a lot of pretty hot emails coming in. And he said, sometimes I'm cranking out a reply to that hot email, and I want to be hot right back. And then I glance over, and I go, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Delete, 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 delete. Now let's try that again. You see how that works? What is God calling me to do in response to this problem? Because I want to make sure that when I respond to a problem, I'm demonstrating integrity. And in order to do that, I've got to respond to this problem with great maturity, dealing with them rightly, dealing with them biblically, dealing with them with great integrity. Let me give you one more ingredient here to this whole recipe for integrity, and that is identity. You see that? Now, you might be thinking, what do you mean by identity? What does that have to do with integrity? I would submit it might be the most important one on the list. Okay? Sometimes we go through life and we set ourselves up to be God. We just say, hey, I'm basically God. Now, how do we do that? You probably don't consciously make that decision. But if you look back at Genesis chapter 2, that very first sin that humanity gets involved in, you know what they were doing? They were setting themselves up to be God. God said, don't eat from this tree, right? This is what is wrong. In other words, God defined what is right and what is wrong. What happens with Adam and Eve? They look at the same tree, and the Bible says, and they saw it, and they said it was good for food. In other words, God doesn't know what he's talking about, this whole right and wrong business. I know what is right and wrong. It is not our job to decide what is right and wrong. That's God's job. You know what our job is? To obey or disobey. That's what we get to do. That's what we choose to do, okay? Sometimes, though, we get our identity a little bit confused, and we set ourselves up to be God, and we start making decisions about what is right and what is wrong on our own. And when we start doing that, you all, your integrity is going to take a beating. For example, you may not think that that extra flirtation in the office with that coworker is a problem. You may think, that's no big deal, totally innocent. Is it? Or are you setting yourself up to blow the lid off of your integrity? You might be thinking, hey, one more drink, it's really not going to make a big difference. I mean, I know better. I know what's right. And so you do it. You know what you're doing? You're setting yourself up to blow the lid off of your integrity. You might be thinking, you know what, I can fudge on my taxes. It's not that big a deal. I know what I'm doing. You know what you're doing? You're setting yourself up to blow the lid off of your integrity. My identity is pretty simple here. I'm not God. God decides what is right and wrong. I decide if I'm going to obey or disobey. And if I'm not God, then who am I? Well, the Bible deals with that beautifully. Look at 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. See how very much our Father loves us, for he calls us his what? Children. There's our identity. And that is what we are. But the people who belong to this world don't recognize that we are God's children because they don't know him. Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is. And all who have this eager expectation will keep themselves, what? Pure, just as he is, what? Pure. As a child of God, what am I fixed on? I'm fixed on him. He is the standard of what is pure and impure, right and wrong. That's on him. My decision, my job, to decide to obey. I'm God's child. And so when I'm at the kind of at a crossroads on my integrity, I've got a decision to make. My decision is simply to ask this: what would God have me do in this moment? And when I make that choice, my integrity is going to come through unscathed because I'm behaving within the context of my identity in Christ. And as a Christ follower, then, that really makes it simple for me because all I need to do is constantly flex back on what it means to be a child of God. If I say, for example, to my family, hey, I'm a Christ follower, it's important that I worship God, then what do they need to catch me doing? Worshiping God. If I say to my family, hey, I'm a Christ follower and I believe the Bible is important, then what do they need to catch me doing? Being in the Word. If I say to my family or to my coworkers, hey, it's important to me as a Christ follower that I be a person of great honesty and be a person of the truth, then what do they need to catch me doing? Being a person of honesty, being a person of the truth. Do you see where I'm going? Do you see how my identity intersects with my integrity? And I would submit to you all, there's your recipe: compassion, truth, problem solving, and identity. If I want to be a person of integrity, I need to do well on the entire recipe. It's not just one thing. I can be a person of great compassion and dishonest, no integrity. I can be a great problem solver, no compassion, not a person of integrity. I can forget who I am in Christ and make up my own rules as I go, no integrity. It takes all four. So let me just ask you this week, what are you going to do about it? Think about it for a moment. Let's just break down the recipe piece by piece. Think about compassion. Ask yourself honestly. It's always good to self-evaluate first. Ask yourself honestly, how am I doing on compassion? Do I really get down and understand people's problems from their level? And then does that move me to act? Just ask yourself. Be honest with yourself. And then score yourself 1 to 10. How am I doing? And then let me challenge you all. This week, make it a goal to show at least one act of compassion and make sure you get your family engaged. Remember, we're trying to set them on a course where we go from generation to generation to generation of Christ followers. You can't leave them out. What am I going to do to show them great compassion and lead them to be people who show great compassion? What about the next one? What about truth? Okay, self-evaluation time. Do I handle the truth well? Give yourself a score, 1 to 10. And then this week, be honest. What is that one area where you've got a real hole in dealing with the truth? Where you're prone to be dishonest? Just make the decision. I'm going to deal with this problem with honesty. Maybe I haven't been bringing honesty into this thing up until now, but I'm going to bring honesty into this thing from now on. I'm going to deal well with the truth, okay? Look at the next one, problem solving. Once again, do you solve problems promptly or do you let them drag out? Do you deal rightly with conflict? I love Hebrews 12:14. It tells us that we should strive to be at peace with everyone. Wow, that's a high bar, right? That's a high bar. How are you doing on problem solving? Give yourself a score, 1 to 10. And then this week, make a commitment. I'm going to solve that problem that I've been putting off. I'm going to solve that problem this week. I'm not going to let this drag out any further. Last one up there, identity. Who am I in Christ? Just evaluate yourself. Be honest. Do you tend to set yourself up to be God? Is that who you are? Is that what you do? Just be honest about that. Or is your identity firmly anchored in being the child of God? And so, rate yourself 1 to 10. How do I do there? And then challenge yourself this week. this week I'm going to drop out of God mode. That's not who I'm going to be. I'm going to drop out of God mode. I'm going to remind myself that I am a child of God. He decides what is right and wrong. I decide if I'm going to obey or disobey. I'm going to choose to obey because that helps me clearly model integrity. Just work your way all through it. All four pieces, all four ingredients. Am I a person of integrity? Do I show compassion, truth, problem solving, identity? Am I a person of integrity when I look at all four of those? Now, I want you to flex back for just a moment on the idea of identity for just a little bit longer. And I say that because some of you all are not in a relationship with Christ right now. Your identity is not that as a child of God. And the Bible teaches us that if that's the case, if that's where we are, then in effect we've set ourselves up to be a competitor to God. We're effectively saying, God, I'm running my own show. And that decision separates us from God. It puts us in a position where we're sinning against Him. And that has huge implications for who we are. So I would just challenge you to really put that sensation to the test. Really challenge yourself. Is that where I am? Have I ever made a decision to be in a relationship with God, to be His child? And let me just tell you, there's no better day to make that decision than today. Just simply say, Lord, today I want to begin my relationship as your child. And then come out and let's talk about that at a place we call Fresh Start, right out there on the runway. Let's have that conversation. Let's take a moment. Let's pray right now together as we think about integrity. Lord, we thank you for the people of integrity that you've placed in our life. Virtually everybody in this room can see someone, can think of someone that they think of as a person of great integrity. And Lord, we know that the future of our family and its trajectory in Christ depends in some part on our being people of integrity, of modeling the gospel and of being thoroughly your child. In front of our kids, they see everything we do. Our spouse sees everything we do. Our neighbors, they see what we do. And our testimony, our witness, won't go forward with great clarity if we are not people of integrity. So challenge us, Lord, on each of these four areas to be a person of great integrity. And Lord, I pray for those who are in this room who are not in a relationship with you. I pray, Lord, that that changes today, that their identity switches from someone who's placed themselves in the position of being God to being instead a child of God. There's so much freedom in being in you. And I pray that people make that choice today. We love you, Lord. We thank you for your word and for what you've taught us through it. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone agreed and said, amen.